Everyone, welcome back to Daily Devotions. Pastor Steve here. How blessed we are to be able to walk in the Word of God together, and what a joy it is to be able to walk, especially in this rescue story, the story that's always of God rescuing, showing grace, but also forming and shaping a community. And how beautiful it is, what a joy it is, that every single day we can reflect back on the grace and the mercy and actually be raised up, maybe woken up into his grace and mercy, but also each and every day he forms and shapes us just in alignment with better what he has for his community. And so as we've ventured with Israel, we're now in Exodus chapter 19, and we come to the place where now they just camp out. They camp out for the rest of Exodus, for the rest of Leviticus, the first 10 chapters of Numbers. This is an important place because at this place, at this region, as we call it, in the desert of Sinai, on the mountain of God, in the Mount of Sinai, they receive their incredible shaping of receiving the law, receiving the commands, receiving how they walk as a community, how they will worship as a community, what they'll look like, what's the order of their community, who are they as the people of God. This is all directed and coming at this mountain. And so only 3 months, kind of interesting, because we always see the wanderings, you know, as going here and there. After 3 months, they've come from Egypt on the very day, it says right here at the beginning of 19, on the very day. So we're talking about the 14th day in the Passover, right? 14th day of the first month. Now we're on to the third month on the 14th day. Here they arrive in the presence of God and what they will need for the next long haul of years. And as they are wandering in the desert, now they're living, they're remaining, they're encamping at the Mount Sinai within the desert of Sinai. So let's pick it up, Exodus chapter 19, God continuing to use Moses as that leader, continuing to speak to Moses, continuing to speak to his people in the midst of their wandering, in the midst of where they are. Chapter 19, verse 1. In the third month after the Israelites left Egypt, on the very day, this was that 14th day, 14th, 15th day, they came to the desert of Sinai. After they set out from Rephidim, they entered the desert of Sinai, and Israel camped there in the desert in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, "This is what you are to say to the house of Jacob and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself." What an incredible reference, because the eagle's wings has something to do with stillness, right? Be still. All you have to do is be still and the Lord will fight for you, right? The stillness of the soaring of the eagle, it just like cuts through the air. It seems so simple to be able to actually soar as that eagle. Exactly what Israel had. What did they do? What did they do to escape from Egypt? No, it was the Lord's doing. What did they do to be able to get away from Pharaoh's army? The Lord did that, spread the waters, and they walked through. It seems pretty simple what they had, because God was doing the work. He says, "How I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself." Now here we get to see at the Mount Sinai the presence of God. He brought them to himself. Now, that's been in the cloud and in the pillar of fire. As he's leading them, they get to see that. But here they're going to really know. They're really going to really experience that presence of God on this mountain. He says, verse 5, "Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be my treasured possession." What is his covenant? His covenant is all the way back with Abraham. That he's going to bless these people. He's going to multiply these people, that they're going to be the people that are going to be the light to the nations. People are going to know God because of how Israel knows their God, of how Israel walks, how Israel makes decisions, how Israel goes to war. They're going to know, the nations around them are going to know who their God truly is. "Although the whole earth is mine," verse 6, "you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites. You are going to be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Excuse me. Holy, I say it quite often, but just want to reiterate it here. Holy means set apart. They're going to be set apart. They're going to look different. They're going to be a nation that is of the Lord. Not going to be a nation of their own. They're going to be a nation of the Lord. And they're going to be a kingdom of priests. Ones who, frankly, devote themselves to the Lord. So, verse 7, Moses went back and summoned the elders of the people and set before them all the words the Lord had commanded him to speak. The people all responded together, "We will do everything the Lord has said." So, Moses brought their answer back to the Lord. The Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to come to you in a dense cloud so that the people will hear me speaking with you and will always put their trust in you." Then Moses told the Lord what the people had said. And the Lord said to Moses, "Go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day. Because on that day the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. Put limits for the people around the mountain and tell them, be careful that you do not go up the mountain or touch the foot of it. Whoever touches the mountain shall surely be put to death." They are finding out and realizing and understanding that God's presence is set apart. It is holy, even holier than them. They're going to be a holy nation. They're going to be set apart from all the people of the world. But God is even more set apart. His power, his majesty, but here his holiness is something that humanity cannot embrace, cannot do. So if you touch, if you're close, you will surely die, unless God shows incredible grace that he does to Moses, right? Verse 13, "He shall surely be stoned or shot with arrows." Whoa. "Not a hand is to be laid on him. Whether man or animal, he shall not be permitted to live. Only when the ram's horn sounds a long blast, may they go up to the mountain." There are boundaries. There are decrees. Will you listen to the commands of the Lord? Yes, we will do everything the Lord. Then don't go near the mountain. That's your first command. Don't go near the mountain. I'm putting these decrees before you. If you do it, you'll die. And he's setting before them a being able to say, if you don't follow the commands of God, surely you will die. But if you follow the commands of God, you will live. He's starting to put this forth, being able to say, you're in God's way, you live. You're not in God's way, you will die. Sin leads to death. That's a separation from God. But the gift of life is actually being with God. Verse 14, "After Moses had gone down the mountain to the people, he consecrated them and they washed their clothes. Then he said to the people, prepare yourselves for the third day. Abstain from sexual relations. Don't have anything distracting you." You see how he just aims at humanity? What a distraction. Not saying sexual relations are a full distraction, but they are necessarily something selfish in nature, especially in our sinful nature. He said abstain from that because you need to be devoted towards the Lord. It also, actually, sexual relations in that culture in that time made people unclean. Women unclean, men unclean, association within that. So abstain from that because you've just washed your clothes. You've just devoted yourselves to the Lord. Now devote yourselves actually mind, body, and soul. That's what sexual relations actually do. They're mind, body, and soul. They actually are devoted towards God here. Verse 16, "On the morning of the third day, there was thunder and lightning with a thick cloud over the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp trembled. Then Moses led the people out of the camp and to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord descended on it in fire. The smoke billowed up from it like smoke from a fire, from a furnace. The whole mountain trembled violently, and the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder. Then Moses spoke, and the voice of God answered him." I mean, can you imagine this scene? Talk about fear and trembling. "The Lord descended to the top of Mount Sinai and called Moses to the top of the mountain. So Moses went up, And the Lord said to him, go down and warn the people so that they do not force their way through to see the Lord, and many of them perish. Even the priests who approach the Lord must consecrate themselves, or the Lord will break out against them. Moses said to the Lord, the people cannot come up Mount Sinai, because you yourself warned us. Put limits around the mountain and set it apart as holy. The Lord replied, go down and bring Aaron up with you. But the priests and the people must not force their way through to come to the Lord, or he will break out against them. So Moses went down to the people and told them. You're going to start to see a little bit of the limits of the people, but a little bit of the approach of God. And you're thinking, well, he's not really approaching. Yes, he is approaching, because he gives the words to Moses, and then he releases Moses into the people. The people can't handle the majesty and the holiness and the otherness of God. They are awestruck with that. That's why they're saying, don't come forward, because you're like drawn to it. But here's how God always works. God approaches humanity. God approaches Israel. He does it in a certain way. He's going to do it through Moses. He's going to do it through the sacraments. He's going to do it through his commands. God, in his holy majesty and otherness, doesn't just attract people to himself. No, actually, he goes to them. We see that in Moses. We see that towards Israel. But obviously, as you're connecting the dots, we see that in the celebration of Christmas, where God comes into flesh, and he comes and approaches humanity in his son, Jesus. And so receive that today. Receive that incredible majestic view and the trembling of that mountain. But receive this today. God comes to you. He will pursue you in his commands, his decrees, in his forming and shaping, in his grace and his mercy today. It's new every morning, and he's approaching you with it. And so be blessed this day, knowing that God isn't up in just his heavenly throne, just trembling and shaking and being able to majestic in that way. No, he approaches you in his word. He approaches you in the body of believers. He approaches you with his grace and mercy this day. And to that, let's live this day in the incredible response that we are to do in saying, thanks be to God.